Thanks for having me. I actually thought I was going to go before Vinay, but this will be good because I can refer to his content now in what I give here. Here are some synonyms in the space. This one on the bottom is the one that we tend to use most often because it speaks to the paradigm shift that really happens when you get in this space. Really, self-sovereign identity is a lifetime portable identity fully controlled by a person, organization, or thing that cannot be taken away. And that's important because it shifts the responsibility away from identity providers to the actual individual. And when you kind of shift that paradigm, it stops being a government ID or an Amazon ID or a bank ID. It starts becoming my ID, and I get to control who I engage with and what level of data sharing I do and how I interact with them. It really kind of shifts the balance. And the paradigm shift shows up in interesting ways. I'll talk about a few of those. Now, I'm going to tell a bit of a story about kind of the evolution of thought of the creators of Sovereign. And when I say creators, it started with two guys in a diner lamenting the state of the world, state of the digital world. And it kind of grew from there to where we have hundreds in the orbit that are actively working on the Sovereign code base itself or working on applications that run on top of Sovereign. So one thing I want to mention too about self-sovereign identity is that there's a major shift away from the thinking of logging in. Login is kind of one way to think about identity, but what actually, and I love that I think Anton's slides mentioned trust and mentioned interactions. When you make this paradigm shift, you move to a new way of interacting where a person on a website is not a subject. That person is a peer with any kind of online service provider. And they have more control about their situation. And the interactions that are enabled are much more broad than we are thinking today. So sitting across the table from Timothy Ruff is my co-founder at Evernym. We talked about this and we lamented that there's a lack of privacy and a lack of control. And we wanted to help solve that problem. We also felt like it was an artificial zero-sum game where service providers wanted to gather as much information about us as they could, that was to market to us. We were scared to use our Facebook ID to log in because we might get some post about given to us by Facebook using kind of us as a puppet promoting their product, or asking for an email address to get a white paper and finding out that now your email address has been sold. And so we were worried about this state of affairs, and the surveillance economy was in full swing, and it still is. The Snowden revelations had just happened, and Americans were concerned, and people outside of America were concerned. And so this was something that was a deep concern for us. And we were living in this sea of data breaches. Ashley Madison had happened, and the Target violations had happened, and there were so many personal identifiable information had been leaked, and we were concerned about that. And when we were designing our system, it was a centralized system. We were having a hard time saying that, yes, use our system and we'll just have a taller firewall, a thicker firewall. We'll have the best systems administrators we can find. And we said, no, we're not going to do that. And then blockchain came into our radar. And I'll tell you, we were as naive as anybody else when we started looking at this technology. And we started by saying, let's put identifiers, keys, and assertions on the ledger. That was really kind of where we started. And we started realizing there's some major problems with this. So I'm going to talk a little bit as we evolved our thinking about the challenges we ran into and kind of what the contributors to Sovereign have solved and are solving. The biggest issue we ran into with this notion was correlation risk. If I have a digital driver license assertion on a public ledger and I share that with someone, I can prove that I'm a certain age or that I can drive, and I share that with a second person, there's now this universally unique identifier they can use to create some kind of a coalition of a data sharing kind of service providing that they could sell. And it really kind of created a clearinghouse for trading of my personal information. And that to me was untenable. That to us was untenable. We didn't want to make things worse with our efforts. And so we dived into a couple of things that we did here. Number one, if we think about decentralization as being important, if you start centralizing all of your data onto a blockchain, you kind of defeated the purpose. So get everything out to the edge. Agents are a notion where you have some trusted software or semi-trusted that acts on behalf of me. So I have a phone, and this phone rarely leaves my side. I have an agent running on this phone that does things for me. And a way to think about it is none of us actually sign anything digitally. We can't digitally sign anything. With a pen and paper, I can sign something, but my digital signature is really me controlling a piece of logic and a key. And so rather than talk about Alice or Bob and their keys, we talked about Alice and Bob and their agents, which had keys. This was a fundamental shift in our thinking, and it really opened up a lot more possibilities. This allowed us to move things off ledger that were previously on ledger. This helped to kind of free up the load on the ledger, which is always an issue. Scaling is a predominant problem in blockchain technologies. And it also helped to reduce risk of inference-based timing attacks or side-channel attacks. The thing that we realized is I couldn't reshare the identifiers. That was really critical. And so everything had to be pairwise. And so this is like real life. And Rutger and I have a relationship, and I can communicate with Rutger using an identifier and keys, but Vinay and I also have a relationship, and I shouldn't be using the same identifiers and the same keys in that relationship. This small shift in thinking had big impacts on the number of keys we had to manage. It also had big impacts on how do we make sure that those relationships can leverage credentials or signed documents, travel documents, whatever I had, across those relationships without creating that correlation. So signatures are correlating. This was a big learning experience. If you get a driver license and the driver license signs that driver license, a digital signature that allows you to prove that license came from the driver license division, that signature is universally unique. There is none other like it, and if you share that signature with more than one party, you've created correlation. And that was a really critical learning. So we needed credentials that were portable across relationships and were not linkable. And we found the same technology that others have found in zero-knowledge proofs. Now, this is a colleague of mine is famous for saying exotic crypto. I would say it is exotic, but it's been around for decades. It just hasn't been widely used as much. A good example of Well, let me talk through this. I think I'll show this. With these special signatures, you can prove that you have a driver license without actually sharing your driver license. You can prove that it's not expired, that you can prove a single attribute. You can do selective disclosure on that driver license. And even more exotic than the others is I can prove a fact about attributes that are in my driver license. Like, for example, my driver license could show my birth date, but I could prove that I'm over 18 without revealing my birth date and without even revealing my age. And that's pretty significant power. And the reason for that power is the kind of interactions it now enables. And when we say that, we say we can prove it in zero knowledge. So this is the thing we had to define, number one, and implement to make the kind of interactions we were seeking to be possible. And then, of course, you need revocation. This proved to be even more difficult than the initial credentials, because you had to prove that your license was valid, even if, you had to prove that your license was valid without disclosing who you were. You couldn't have a list of revoked license numbers, because if you prove that you're not in that list of revoked license numbers, you're showing who you are. So this was very tricky, and we used Sovereign to do that, using a concept called cryptographic accumulators. And there's lots of reasons why you'd want to do revocation. A mistake, or a system was hacked, you'd want to be able to revoke and reissue if that were appropriate. We got a lot of pushback on this. Zero-knowledge crypto is really hard. We also heard that they're going to correlate you anyway. They'll just ask for more information until they get enough information to correlate you. But we believe that if this becomes widespread use, that the prescriptive legislation we have in place today will start to accommodate for this. And you won't have the same kind of legislation over time. And there'll be opportunities to let people that are asking for information, too much information for a particular type of interaction, they would be encouraged. There can be some reputation around that. And the apps that we use can tell us if, for this particular type of interaction, are we being asked too much information? Is it too specific? So I think there's a lot of opportunities here. And I spent the afternoon yesterday, I'm gonna talk about a group that I met yesterday, the IRMA project. IRMA stands for I Reveal My Attributes. I love what they're doing, and they have implemented a lot of the same things we have. So I see a lot of synergies, and I look for opportunities to collaborate with them, because there's a tremendous amount of intellectual capital in this space, in this country, and I'm thrilled to see that. I'm going to move a little faster. How much time do we have? Do we know? How many? 20 more minutes? Okay.
Yeah, we have until 2:30 to dive into this stuff. So
okay. Well, I'll try to leave like some time for Q&A too.
Yeah.
All right. So, and I'm telling you this from a sovereign perspective, but anybody who wants to do the same kind of thing that we're doing is going to deal with the same issues. They may say that, well, the privacy thing is something we'll put on later. That would make me nervous. The implications of what we're doing here are pretty far-reaching, and so we have to get it right. It doesn't mean it has to be perfect, but it has to be right in the right areas. So how do we stop a service provider from impersonating us? I talked about those agents. What if someone that's hosting my agent, someone compromised that agent, could they impersonate me? And this caused us to move down the path of making sure that every agent has its own keys. I mentioned that earlier. Never copy private keys. And then we use cloud agents. So cloud agents and edge agents, we created this distinction between agents that I controlled or agents that I had on hardware that I physically controlled or agents that existed in someone else's data center, someone else's control. And this allowed us to kind of distinguish. Cloud agents could be always online. My edge agent on my phone might actually be, battery could be dead or it could be out of cell service. And then the cloud agent, I could say, well, let me do kind of low trust things there. Like the cloud agent could be a message proxy to my edge agent. So there's lots of opportunities to kind of differentiate what kinds of things you place where. And these agents, you can think of an agent like, my business partner has used this analogy, and I always chuckle when he uses it, but then I find that I go to it. Who's seen Iron Man? Right? You know who Jarvis is? Jarvis is Tony Stark's agent. And when Jarvis kind of went rogue, that's really a question of key management. So anyway, it's an interesting way to think about it. It's something that works for me. And when I drive, I was driving home a few months ago, maybe longer, and I had a new phone, and my phone told me that on my way home there was an accident and I should take a different route. And I was I was at the same instant, I was grateful and I was mortified. Grateful that my phone's operating system manufacturer thought that that was something that they could help me evade that accident, but I was also concerned that there was some server out there that was watching what I was doing every day and inferring from that information where my home was. And I didn't think that that was the kind of information I wanted shared. So agents give you an ability to have kind of that collective intelligence value without actually disclosing your specifics. So I'm excited about where this can take us. I mentioned key explosion. If you do the math, you have all people, organizations, and things multiplied by every relationship that they have multiplied by all their agents. Okay? That's a pretty big number there. And so we had to have a system that managed, that was able to support that. And so the number of things that we did there, three things. Hierarchical deterministic keys. These are a kind of a way to have derived keys. We do this on the agents. Microledgers, which I'll talk about in a second, and DKMS stands for Decentralized Key Management System. Microledgers allowed us to move a lot of things we were doing on the ledger into small, I mean, when I say microledgers, I'm talking about just, you know, several bytes or kilobytes of data on devices, and not having to use the ledger, the public ledger directly, and just using the public ledger for certain things that kind of helped give you same kinds of security guarantees. There's a lot behind this. I could spend a few hours talking about this. This is exciting, and we'll be publishing. We've got some documentation on this that we've been writing up, and we'll be publishing that on the Sovereign website soon. That's exciting. This is another area of a lot of focus. Key management is a hard problem. Anybody who lives and works in this space understands how difficult this is. And what we're talking about here is pushing keys to the edge. And so we're creating a requirement that we have amazing key management on devices. And we need to have a system that allows for a device to be fully compromised. We can't depend on the security of some TPM or secure element on this device. You can't depend on that. And so you have to have a system that works in a more diffuse trust model. And so we'll be publishing some research that we've done in this space that I think will be very useful. There's a number of things that we're doing here that's exciting, How do you provision new agents, new keys? How do you bootstrap a new connection? How do you back up a wallet securely? How do you use the trusted relationships that you have with your friends and family and with your organizations that you trust to create a recovery scenario that really is secure? This is exciting innovation, and we're not done yet. There's a lot of work to do there, and this is space that we need help. Scale, I'll just talk briefly about this. The consensus protocols that we used because we needed something that was fast and cheap, we used a consensus protocol that is typically used in a private ledger. But we kind of decided to create our own category here. Usually private means permissioned, and public means permissionless. And we're basically straddling the fence here. It's a public distributed ledger using a permissioned Byzantine fault-tolerant consensus algorithm. And when we went down this space, we had to have an algorithm that was resilient to denial of service attacks and all the other Byzantine faults that are out there. Nothing against Byzantines, it's just what they call it. It was actually, I won't go into that. but the idea here is that we think that there's a lot of innovation in the space. Somebody at lunch today talked about, I think it was Vinay, talked about proof of stake. And there's a ton of innovation going in here. And my hope and my commitment is as these permissionless consensus algorithms improve, that we're going to start incorporating that into what we've got. This lowers the cost, and with sharding truly allows for a global scale, which is a big feat. Governance, I mentioned governance in the title slide here. Governance is a big deal. How do you make sure that you've got diversity of geography, diversity of legal jurisdiction, diversity of industry in the stewards, which are the hosts for the validation nodes, the miners, if you will, in the sovereign ledger? How do you ensure that the incentives are properly aligned, that that you don't have stewards that are getting wealthy and creating perverse incentives? How do you keep the cost of basic identity transactions low so that the rickshaw driver in Bangladesh who makes €4 per day is not thinking twice about using his self-sovereign identity? Those are really important considerations, and the foundation, the Sovereign Foundation was formed to do just that. It's made up of 12 trustees from around the world. One of them, I don't know if he's here, Bram Nutabom from the Key Foundation is one of the trustees. Very, very forward-thinking person, a very forward-thinking organization about privacy and individual data rights. And then the other piece here is the Sovereign Trust Framework. This is, my colleague Drummond Reed is fond of saying, the BLT. Not the bacon, lettuce, tomato. It's the business, legal, and technology framework for interactions in the system. And there's a tremendous amount of work going on. There's a weekly working group that works on this. We have a provisional trust framework that's been out for like 6 or 8 months. And we're working right now on the general availability trust framework. And we believe this will be a template for other trust frameworks to be built on top of it. Any kind of a consortium or association or alliance could build a trust framework on top of it. So it's a really powerful thing, and I recommend taking a look at it on the sovereign.org website right here. Oh, this is the stewards. So I can't scroll because I just took a screenshot, but if you scroll down, you'd see two folks from the Netherlands two organizations, the Key Foundation and Tyken, are both stewards on the Sovereign Network. Another one I think announced yesterday, I hope I'm right on this, TNO. TNO, great group of people, very forward-thinking, sharp individuals. And they, I think, just announced that that they are a steward. They've been approved and are there. This list is growing, and it's going to evolve over time. And we're working on, you know, we're getting bigger and bigger organizations that are interested. We are trying to maintain diversity, but we do have three stewards in the state of, or in the country of the Netherlands. And I think it's really a testament to how much is happening here. It's really quite amazing. There's a link to the Sovereign Trust Framework. This is the kind of the launching page for it. Recommend taking a look at this. This is being extended and implemented in a lot of other areas, so this is something worth looking at. It was really important that Hyperledger India, so Hyperledger Project is kind of a collection of blockchain initiatives, and Brian Bellendorf, who's the director, executive director, and we had conversations over time, and he really encouraged us to participate. And this is great because they have great governance. It's the Linux Foundation. The open source license is a very permissive license. It's Apache 2, which means that the risks of it being forked are lower because of its being a permissive license. This is a screenshot from that URL. And I think these slides are going to be available, so you can get these later. But here's the project itself. I didn't get a shot of the JIRA page. The JIRA page shows all of the work that's happening. There's a tremendous amount of work that's happening. You kind of see how much by the commit history in this project. So this is good. And this is only one of the projects. This is Indie Node, but there's three or four of these. There's an Indie crypto, I think, that's going to be happening soon, where we'll pull out a lot of the crypto and start working with other people in the Hyperledger project. Yeah, don't write this down, but these are just some kind of reference material. I do want to mention with Key Foundation and Tyken and TNO and Irma, I'm like I said before, I'm really impressed with what's happening here. I know there's an initiative, I'm going to mispronounce this, but the Groningen Declaration is really interesting to us because it talks about student data portability. That's those kinds of opportunities to participate and help where we can are huge. And so I'll just say we're not done yet. We don't have it all solved. We thought probably deeper about some of these things than others have, and others have probably thought deeper than we have, but there are there's a lot to do, and there's a lot of momentum here, and would love participation and pull requests, as we call it in the coding community. So thanks. Just one last thing. It's not about identity. It's about what's enabled on it. So we kind of get myopic a little bit when we talk about identity, but when I sat across from Vinay last night and we were talking about what we could do kind of in the next two or three months, it got really exciting because we started to see that, hey, you could prove in zero knowledge that you have enough insurance to cover a certain threshold. That's powerful. The technology that we've got here allow you to prove things about yourselves and create accountability for things without strong identification. And I think that's, you could be identified if you want to be, but the technology allows it so you don't have to be. So the insurance thing's super exciting to me, and I sent a note last night saying to some of the trustees at the Sovereign Foundation that said we really need to be a participant in this. So excited about that. It's about what we can do with it.
It's a capability without identity.
Yes, capability without identity.